what we're going to do is a Q&A session, because we feel that what people want is to speak, to ask, to share their doubts or their hopes. So we're going to sit here, Carlos and I, and we're going to answer, or he's going to answer your questions. I'm going to be the moderator. We have a wireless mic, and this beautiful woman, who happens to be my wife, will pass along the mic. So let's begin. First question. Alvaro. Alvaro has a question. You can ask the questions in English or Catalan, however you're more comfortable.
Hi. So, welcome. Thank you for coming, Carlos. The question here is that we hear in this debate that we're this process we're having in Catalonia. We usually have this debate about whether the small companies or medium-sized companies would be hurt or would benefit from an eventual independence from Catalonia, given the fact that Spain is probably the major trade partner for many of those companies. So what would you say, or could you comment on, you know, whether you could bring some peace of mind to those, or they should be worried about? How do you see this unfolding?
So thank you for inviting me. It's a pleasure to be here. I see lots of friends. I hope that you are still friends of mine after I talk. Thank you for the question, which is I think it's one of the big questions that is always asked, which is about the economic benefits, the costs, and the benefits of a possible independent state. So I think that to think about this, we have to think about it in terms of two things, right? One is in the long run, and then the short run. So the long run meaning, you know, after everything has been settled, after all the dust has been settled, is it going to be better or not? And then there is the other question, which is the transition itself. So, you know, there is a process, and things are going to change, and this may be costly, right? So, and of course, in the second sense, the cost, or the second side of this, the costs are going to be very related to how the Spanish state and Spanish consumers react to the possibility of independence, right? So, before I talk about trade effects, and I must say that, you know, I'm not a specialist on trade, although I belong to, or I have been part of a group. Besides being in the advisory council, I have been part of the Wilson initiative, which has very good trade theorists like Paul Andras, who is a professor at Harvard. So I'm going to rely more on his expertise than on what I know, right? But before I talk about the trade, let me say that when we think about benefits and costs, I think that what we see clearly is that the benefits are there in the medium to long run. The benefits come in different ways. They come in terms of what we call the difference in what Catalonia pays in taxes and what it receives. The calculations vary, but in general, it's basically about 8% of the whole economy of Catalonia goes to Spain and doesn't come back. So in that sense, if taxes are collected in Catalonia and they do not have to be transferred, this is going to be a big benefit, right? So just in terms of revenue, we have to put that into the sort of positive side of independence in terms of how this is going to affect the lives of everyone. And we also know that when you calculate the costs of for the provision of all the things that have to be paid that now are provided by the Spanish state, that's only a fraction of that quantity, right? So it's going to be positive. And I mean, this is it's obvious, because otherwise Spain would let Catalonia have a referendum and kick Catalonia out, right? So it's not like Scotland and Britain, where the British were happy to have a referendum because, in fact, Scotland is a net receiver of money. So Cameron was, okay with these things. It's the other way around. And otherwise, we would not see this resistance from Spain, right? So that's the first part. The second part is that there has been an important change, I think, globally. And so that's, I'm going to your question in a bit, but it has to do with trade, which is that at this point, a lot of things are done at the European Union level. And what is important is that states in a very competitive world provide the right kinds of things that allow firms to be competitive, right? So to have good connections with markets, either to send, to sort of export goods, or to have their managers of firms go to those places quickly and go back and forth, to provide the kinds of infrastructures that attract firms to invest. All these things are the things that, in a way, we all, the politicians clearly are worried about. They are always trying to fight for the good things that sort of they want to sell location, location, location. And it turns out that the kinds of decisions that are made in the whole Spain are not the kind of things that are the most appropriate for Catalonia, right? So they build a lot of AVEs because they have a different, trains, high-speed trains, that because they have a very different conception of what is right or not, whereas they do not build things such as a good train that connects all the Mediterranean, which is it's where 50% of exports of Spain take place, right? Or the goods go out. So in that sense, for firms, I think that when you put the tax side with politicians that are closer to the needs, the infrastructural needs, the location, location kinds of things that, good education, good roads and so on and so forth, these are going to be beneficial. So I think this is it's clear to us, right? So then the question is more the transition costs. So to go to your question, which is, to what extent, if there is a yes vote and there is a movement towards independence, is there going to be an impact on the exports that Catalonia, Spain is still an important market for Catalan firms. Basically, we know that about 60% or 50% it's now a bit less than 50% of exports, of Catalan exports, go to Spain. Exports as a whole are basically about 60% of the value of the Catalan economy. So some say, if there is independence, then if the Spaniards respond with a boycott and do not buy anything from Catalans, this basically amounts, since it's about 0.5% of the exports of Catalonia, and exports are basically more than half of the whole Catalan economy, this means that the economy of Catalonia is going to fall by like 20% or even 30%, right? So the first thing we have to see here is that it's all about threats, right? So this is a position that relies, it's not about, this is not an automatic thing. It's basically a response by someone that loves you so much that then, basically suffocates you if you want to do something that the other party doesn't want to do. So the relationship is a poison relationship, right? Who wants to, in my view, who wants to be with someone that wants to punish you in that way? So that's the first thing. So it's important to understand that transition costs come from a particular way in which perhaps, the Spanish state and the Spanish customers respond, right? And it's not impossible. I still remember when I'm not sure if I need to go on forever or people are starting. If I see people sort of falling, I mean that they are bored, right? But I still remember in '88 when I came to this country, I went to the Kennedy School, Harvard, and I met this, extremely nice, really nice. We were very good. We became very good friends. A woman from Palencia, and one of the first things that she told me was, I'm a proud granddaughter of people that boycotted Catalan products in response to the Statut d'Autonomia of 1931. And I said, what's going on? I don't care. So it could be, right? So I cannot say, it's not going to happen. No. It's true, though, that the same thing. So boycotting implies also hurting yourself tremendously. Okay, so that's the first thing. So it's not very credible to threaten in a way that, you know, you're threatening the other with shooting yourself into the foot. But it could happen. The second thing that is important is that although exports to Spain may be about 20 to 30% of the Catalan economy in terms of the value, in fact, these exports, a lot of them, so you, when you think about what the things that are being exported, part of them are what we put into the good, right? So we get meat from somewhere and then we build, you know, we make a sausage, right? So from being, from just meat to the sausage, this is the value added of things, right? And but the meat itself, you may be buying it from, I don't know, Morocco or France or whatever. So if you stop selling to Spain, then in fact you stop buying part of what you are selling from somewhere else. So the fact that 30% of the economy, the value of this Catalan economy goes, is based on exports to Spain, doesn't mean that if they boycott everything, which is, you know, 100% is everything, this is going to be 30% of the Catalan economy, since part of it is not going to be bought somewhere else. That's the first thing. The second thing is that a lot of the things that are being manufactured and being sold to Spain are manufactured by multinationals. So Volkswagen, Nissan, Nestle, all these kinds of companies, right? So it's really difficult to believe that first customers in Spain are going to be able to distinguish between the two types of, you know, sort of the Catalan and non-Catalan, and they are also going then to give up on having a nice Volkswagen. Did you tell them that this is sponsored by Volkswagen, by the way? No, it's not. It's not. But we wish, but we haven't been able to reach them yet. So they will come and pay for everything in the future. So that's the second thing, right? So when you start adjusting for these things, when you take into account that part of the things that are being exported, they will not be, in the extreme case of a whole boycott, they will be not bought outside, that there are lots of things that are done by multinational corporations that it's impossible to know where these goods come from. Then when you start thinking about this and when you start thinking about, in fact, what are the kinds of things that are easy to boycott, such as sparkling wine, right? So cava is something that people really... So that's why there are all owners of wineries in Catalonia. Basically, they're the only ones that they are really worried about this, right? Why? Well, because they know that they are the easiest target. So whenever you see someone complaining about something, always think about those that do not say anything or do not complain. Why is that the owner or Why is that Volkswagen never complains about these things? They don't probably care. Whereas Freixenet, they care a lot, right? Because they see the boycotts coming. So in that sense, when you also think about this, it is probably going to be, if there is a boycott, it's going to be on the low side. Our calculations as the Wilson Initiative, and I sort of stop here, put this at 2% at most if there is a strong boycott, at between 2% of the GDP. I would say, you know, that perhaps my colleagues are, or my companions in this are sort of optimistic. Let's say it's like 4%. I talked about an 8% increase every year in terms of the revenue of the Catalan state, and these are transitional costs. So I'm not saying, you know, it's all free and, you know, this is a free lunch. I'm not saying that. I'm saying there is exaggeration into this. It really depends on the other side, and it's still, given what we sort of see, it's difficult to believe that this boycott is going to be terrible and going to last forever.
So what I wanted to ask you is that you have been talking about one of the biggest arguments that the independentist movement has in Catalonia, that it is the economic argument. I think that that argument works very well in Catalonia, but outside, I don't think it works that well. For example, with my wife's family here, with my friends here, they would say things like, well, California's richer, but if they're independent, I don't know if that's enough to become an independent country. My question is, how do you explain the cultural argument outside of the US, outside of Catalonia? Sorry.
So that's also a very good question. I'm sorry, I should not talk as long as I did before. So if you want to interrupt me, yeah, please do. So I think you're right that a lot of the discourse that we have seen and has been built for many reasons has been economic. So the economic issue has been very important. I think it's an important, so personally I think it's an important discourse. I think that countries that feel that they are a nation have the right to determine how they spend their money. But I think that the root of the problem is not really in the part of in economics. And I'm not sure it is either only in the linguistic cultural part. And I think that there is also, you know, so this is this independence movement has many causes or many motives or roots, and different people have come to the table with different types of things. And I think that there is a linguistic cultural argument because, you know, when you go to Catalonia, so there are things that have been sort of normalized, like language in a school, although it's being now challenged by the central government. But things such as the labeling of products is still all in Spanish. Catalan is not official in Europe. There is an imbalanced situation in the use of language in TV and things like that. So I think in that sense, there is also an important cultural linguistic argument. But I think that at the root of this is a constitutional problem, a problem of political guarantees. So Catalans have systematically asked for a autonomy within Spain, ample autonomy. So political autonomy, sovereignty in many issues, and with a willingness to share in some governance structures with the Spanish state. This goes back a long time, so it's not just a question of the last 20 years. It's 30, 50, 100 years. We have a long history of demands in that sense. In 1978, there was a new constitution. In that constitution, there was a pact that recognized not Catalonia as a nation, but a nationality. And it was a pact with a sort of very, a constitution that was very elastic, very flexible. And the expectations in Catalonia were that this would allow for a lot of autonomous government. Things didn't work well. The Spanish state has always intervened. You know, just one example, so there is an ACE report by the Instituto de Estudios Autonomics on this, but so, for example, the power to regulate rivers that are only within Catalonia, so that they start in Catalonia and end up in the Mediterranean in Catalonia, in principle has been transferred to the Catalan government in the Statute of 1980. Yet the Spanish government, even in that, has passed laws to regulate the use of those rivers, right? So in that very silly thing, where, you know, which seems to be protected by the law of autonomy, there is intervention by the Spanish state, right? So then in 2006, there was an attempt, 2005, 2006, there was an attempt to write a new law that was tried to protect Catalan autonomy. And that's why that law was very long. People always complain it was like 200 articles. The idea was that it was so long to be very detailed so that the Spanish state could not get in, right? And it was a failure. So I think that this impossibility of having guarantees from the Spanish state to really protect Catalan autonomy and to, in a way, treat Catalans as second in citizens in those aspirations is what has triggered this movement towards independence, because independence basically means that you have the same powers the others do, right? So you are guaranteed against the intervention, the encroachment of the Spanish state and Catalonia. So to me, that's the fundamental argument that in a way encompasses many others. But I pin down everything on the economic side or the cultural side, but rather on this willingness to have autonomy, sovereignty, and then being denied that possibility all the time. And at some point you say, that's enough, I want to leave.
Thank you. Laia there.
Carlos, I don't know if you already answered this question, because I arrived a bit late. But I was wondering if you can tell us a little bit about the different scenarios of the post 27 September, after the elections.
I don't know. You know, we are in Princeton. We are still building the time machine, and we are almost there. But it only takes you like 10 days into the future and then back. So it's, you know, it's the 12th. So you come to me the 17th, I'll be, no, seriously. So I think that there are three scenarios, right? The first one is the scenario I call defeat. I mean, I call it from the perspective of those that are in favor of independence. And I'm, you know, I have always, explicitly supported this position. So no problem here. Everyone is entitled to defend whatever he or she wants. So there are three scenarios. One is defeat, the other one is what I call victory, and the third one is muddle through. Defeat, means basically that the parties that are in favor of a yes, so this is, for those that do not know, probably all of you know because you are here, so this is an election that has to be thought as a referendum, right? So the referendum has not been possible. So the only solution to this is to go for a revolution, to shut up, revolution, or be peaceful. So shut up, I don't think people want that. Revolution, that's not how Catalans are now. They were like that in the past, perhaps too much. And then there is peaceful decisions through an election. So there are two parties that are in favor, or two coalitions that are in favor of a yes. If they do not get the more than 50% of the votes and do not get more than 50% of the seats, I think that's the end for the time being.
Let me stop you there. So you say 50% of the votes and 50% of the seats in parliament is a defeat? No, it's under 50%, I mean.
Well, it's the, you know, under 50%. It's a defeat in the sense that this, we are taking this as a referendum. So as such, we have been called to the polls. That's what we wanted, or at least some people wanted that. I mean, I think, you know, the majority wanted that. 80% of Catalans say they wanted a referendum. The Spanish government has rejected that. So the only solution is elections. Those elections have to be taken as a referendum, with all the problems that they have. There are many. It's not the best, it's not the optimal way of doing things, right? So if it's less than 50% on both counts, to me this means we are in the Scottish situation. They went to a referendum, they lost, and that's it. Then we'll see, you know, because many other things will happen, right? I mean, who thought that the Scottish National Party would get basically all the seats in the London Parliament, and that now the Labour Party has decided to commit suicide by choosing Corbyn. So, no one. But it's the way it is, so we don't know. Then you have the second, the opposite one, which is victory, which is more than 50% of the votes, and this translates clearly into more than 50% of the seats. The electoral system in Catalonia is proportional, but it has a few things that make it not completely proportional, right? In that case, it's a referendum. The yes has won. It's going to win, if this happens, it would have been in very specific conditions, which is much better than the Scottish conditions if they had won. Why? Because in Scotland it was yes against no. Here what we have is yes, then we have people that are no, clearly, and they are basically, my expectation, I may be wrong because we don't know, that they are like 25% of the vote, and then you have the other quarter of the electorate that is sitting on the fence, really. Some are against, but many are not. In fact, you know, people that are in that coalition, the second to Ada Colau, who is the mayor of Barcelona, went to the demonstration yesterday, which was a big demonstration, clearly pro-independence. So in that situation, I think that that's a yes to independence. And then the question is how you manage that yes. And we can talk about this later. And then you have the third situation in the middle one, which is less than 50% of the votes, but more than 50% of the seats. To me, which is the more likely? I'm being told that it's the more likely. It's the time machine that you have in the new school.
According to the polls, it's the most likely.
Yeah, it's the most likely. This in that situation, I think that it's not a yes in the referendum. On the other hand, and I'm sorry it's so long, we have the venue in, so the Council of Europe asked a bunch of experts to write a set of guidelines on referenda. It's called the Venice Convention. And this Venice Convention says that you only need to have a majority in favor of yes to declare something to be a victory for yes. Right? So a very strict reading of the results would be that you have the yes, that's going to get perhaps less than 50%, but clearly is going to be the winner. Then you have the no's, the clear no's, and then you have those in the middle. And you could sort of exclude those in the middle and say the yes is still going to win over the no. But my sense is that if this is what it happens, then what we are going to see is probably that the Catalan government is going to be the parties of the yes. They are going to go ahead with what they call writing a constitution, and they are probably going to wait for the Spanish elections to happen, and probably they will try to convince those that are not in the yes or the sí to really force a referendum. But of course, this depends again on the results in December.
Thank you. More questions? Somebody? There, Nuria.
Yes, there has been some talk about what will happen in terms of the EU. Let's say if Catalonia was to be independent, would we go for... for a while, what would happen? Would we be part of the euro? Would we not be part of the euro? We would have to have a new currency. What have you got to say about these things? Can you clarify a little bit for us? Thank you.
Okay, so well, there has been a lot of discussion on this, right? And there is a reason to that, and it's related to the benefits of independence. Because the benefits are clear, at least in the medium run, the Spanish state uses the European Union as the big threat, sort of the big stick, to make people afraid. And it's unfortunate that the European Union does not, in a way, discipline Spain, because, in a way, Spain is using the European Union to their benefit, right? This has to do with the kinds of politicians that you have in Europe. Some are really good, some are not. So some are, you know, good friends with the Spaniard ministers and they would do whatever they are told. Others are more civilized. So I still remember a now commissioner in the European Union, Rehm, the Finnish politician, came to Princeton, and on the question of whether what would happen to Scotland if there was a victory for the yes, he refused to answer. He said, I cannot, because I owe myself to both the English and the Scottish voters. That's really the way to go, but some have, you know, some do not do like that. Having said that, in the report that we prepared for the Advisory Council for the National Transition, we, instead of saying it's all easy and no worries, what we develop is a scenario of possibilities. One is that if there is a yes in the independent vote, you automatically are still within the European Union. The second one is that there is what we call an ad hoc procedure. So without getting out of the European Union, you remain while everything is negotiated. The third possibility is that Catalonia is excluded, then has to reapply, follows the normal procedures in the treaties, basically those that are in Article 49. And then the fourth possibility is that it's excluded because Spain vetoes the entry of Catalonia in the European Union. We don't know exactly what is going to happen, right? The first thing that we have to understand is that it is true that if you are excluded, so if you go out and you have to apply, there is a principle of unanimity to be accepted. So Spain has always a veto, right? But there is a problem with this, that for Spain to do this, first it has to recognize Catalonia as a state, because you cannot exclude someone if that someone doesn't exist, right? And so what cannot be is that you have one minister one day saying that you are going to be excluded, and then the second day, the same minister or his friend saying that you will never be recognized. This cannot be. The two things cannot be. That's, you know, logic that we learned in high school, or I don't know, perhaps, you know, in first grade, something like that, right? You cannot have both things at the same time. Having said that, what is the situation with the European Union? Well, it's a very complicated one because no one has thought about this in the European Union, right? As I said, there is an article that says that to get in, you have to have the unanimous support of all the states in the Union. On the other hand, the article following 49 says that if you want to leave the European Union, you have to negotiate your exit from the European Union. So if Cameron wins the yes, the yes to exit, the Brexit option won in Britain in a year from now, it would not be automatic. The London government would have to go to Brussels, would have to sit down, negotiate an agreement with the European Union, and in case there was no agreement, it would have to wait 2 years to get out, because it's really difficult. There are so many laws. Everything is so, it so depends on many things that Brussels has and Strasbourg they have done, that you need a lot of time to get out. So it's unclear, right? And this is not something I'm saying. This is something that a former judge in the European Court of Justice has written about it. And so his interpretation is that since we do not know, probably two things are important. One is that the fundamental principles of the European Union should apply, and those are of principles of cooperation, of democracy. And second, that politics will matter a lot, right? So that, in fact, we know that the European Union has, when politics, they have demanded that, they have changed things to accommodate. So I'm not saying it's clear that Catalonia is not going to be excluded, but it's really unclear to me that it's going to be excluded, especially, and I finish here, because there are so many firms like Volkswagen, our friend, and many others, you know, there are thousands of firms that work in Catalonia that need legal security and certainly are going to lobby their governments to solve this in some way. But for this to happen, first, the 50% vote for yes has to happen, right?
Vull donar les gràcies al ministre Margallo per haver-nos posat aquestes obres aquí al costat. Okay, more questions. Who has a question? Francesc.
Even if independence gets a resounding majority, it's foreseeable that Spain is gonna use everything it has available, its judiciary, legislative action to block any steps that a future government takes towards independence. So I think the question is, at one point, is the future Catalan government prepared to break with Spanish legality? And you know, what historical examples have we seen of, or are we seeing of that in other countries that have, you know, had an independence process?
So yeah, so you know, if there is a resounding victory, which to me is just 50% plus one vote in favor of yes, then the advice of the, you know, given by the advisory council is to proceed in the following way. So the first thing is to have a formal declaration of sovereignty in parliament that we decided to distinguish in a sort of, you know, thing, it's an invention, a legal invention, but it's nice, you know, it's innovate in constitutional law, separate that from the proclamation of independence, and then ask the Spanish government to negotiate the period of transition. If this doesn't happen, I mean, if the Spanish government doesn't want to negotiate, the idea is to set up a deadline after which there is a complete declaration or proclamation. So the question is, what's happened? So if they want to negotiate, that's great. If they do not, and you know, may want to negotiate sort of pushed by other states, who knows, perhaps. I'm not saying it's going to happen, it could be. If they do not, then the question is, to what extent, as you said, the Catalan government would be willing to stop obeying the institutions of the Spanish state. And that's where, you know, it's a question of the capacity of Catalan society to mobilize, to support these actions, right? So that's why it's very important to have a 50% plus one. Doesn't mean, as I said, that everything will stop if it doesn't happen, but if you have that, then there is enormous legitimacy, because remember that at least in polls that were conducted like 1 or 2 years ago, 80% of the population were in favor, in Catalonia, were in favor of holding a referendum, but 90% said that they would be okay with any result. That's even better, right? It's better to have 90% of the population accepting the idea of Catalonia having the right to decide and then supporting that decision than supporting the referendum itself. I don't know, you know, it, but this is exactly, you know, what... So there are two fundamental things that the Catalan government needs. One is to to control the administration, that people follow their orders, and second, that they have the money to pay. And that's the critical point. But I think that with the 50 plus one, these things will become slightly clearer. I also want to tell you that I'm not in contact with the Catalan government anyway, so I don't know what they think, what they believe, what they plan. It may be that they will again go back to Spain asking for a referendum, because the point, and this is something that it comes from below, it's more an invention of the people than the government, that's what is really nice about this process, is that the idea is to do a lot of, to be very pedagogical, right? To show that all the ways, all the, that we have been given all kinds of chances to the Spanish state to accept the possibility of a democratic decision, and that this has not happened. And that independence, if it comes, is the last resort, right? Because at the end, independence is a big thing. When you're independent, it's not big. But the transition in itself is difficult. And today, the normatively, constitutionally, you know, public opinion is interested in other things like soccer and so on, but, you know, the sort of enlightened philosophers and so on, like, you know, Jordi and others, what they want is to have reasons, you know, sufficient reasons to support you. And I think that the fundamental sufficient reason is I wanted autonomy. I couldn't get the guarantees to get it. I tried everything. I didn't kick anyone. I was not violent. I tried everything talking. And at the end, they didn't listen. So I think it's time to go. And in that sense, if that's done well, I think this is going to legitimize the process inside, but also outside.
Okay, so that's it. It's almost 12, almost noon. Thank you, Carlos. Please, a round of applause for...